leaders. We don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories. We tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
It's the Philippines.
And we are ANC.
Good morning, I'm Mike Navalio. Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, the Philippines' register, or the Philippines registers its highest COVID-19 positivity rate ever, with more than 1 in 4 people tested turning out positive for the disease. Health workers from various hospitals set to stage walkouts today due to the delayed payout of COVID-19 benefits. Over 1,500 victims of the Duterte administration's war on drugs call for an all-out probe by the International Criminal Court. And U.S. President Joe Biden warns of immense devastation as Ida makes landfall in Louisiana as a Category 4 hurricane. Thanks for joining us. The Philippines records its highest COVID-19 positivity rate ever since the start of the pandemic. At 27.9%, more than 1 in 4 people being tested turns out positive for COVID. This is way above the World Health Organization's prescribed 5% positivity rate for an outbreak to be considered under control. On Sunday alone, the country logged 18,528 new cases, pushing the number of active infections to over 143,000, the highest since April 17th. Cases also averaged around 16,000 per day. Last week, another record high.
Parang nanonood tayo ng UAAP game yan eh, na puno yung stadium, no? Punuan hanggang taas ng stadium. So ganun palala yung numbers na nakikita natin ngayon. At nangyayari yan, Michael, on the average ha, araw-araw.
101 more deaths and nearly 18,000 recoveries were also reported. The rise in the positivity rate comes as the Philippines detects over 500 more cases of the highly contagious Delta COVID-19 variant. According to the Health Department, 5 of these patients have died while 6 remain active. 473 were tagged as local infections coming from different areas in the country, with the National Capital Region, Calabarzon, and Central Luzon recording the highest numbers of cases. The new tally pushes the country's total number of Delta variant cases to more than 1,700. Health workers may have been dubbed as the heroes of this pandemic, but many of them have yet to receive the benefits promised to them by government for their service. Out of sheer frustration, some of them will begin staging walkouts today as the country marks National Heroes Day. The walkout is expected to take place in 10 private hospitals, according to Alliance of Health Workers President Robert Mendoza. Noise barrages and other forms of protest will also be conducted by medical frontliners.
Pagdating sa ayuda ng gobyerno, wala po talaga. Inaalalayan lang kami ng management pagdating dun sa meals, accommodation, kahit pa paano, nagkakipagtulungan kami sa management. Hindi nga po yung isa rin ang kailangan namin eh. Kailangan namin dito yung ayuda ninyo sa meals, accommodation, saka transportation allowance at yung sinasabi nilang compensation sa aming mga healthcare workers, yung mga tinamaan.
Ang aming mga fears ay mahihinto, di ba, ang serbisyo at saka yung hindi matutugunan kaagad yung mga pangangailangan ng pasyente.
Vice President Lenny Robredo slamming the delayed payout of benefits for frontliners. That's after Health Secretary Francisco Duque III said it could take 2 months before all the special risk allowances and other intended benefits can be released. Some lawmakers continue to call for Duque's resignation.
Dapat sana nung may naghihinaing, dapat nga hindi na natin hinintay na nagreklamo sila, di ba?
Kung talagang nakikita mo na kailangan mo nang mag-resign ka, no? Para mabigyan din ng laya ang mga nag-iimbestiga kung totoo nga merong anomalya, kung merong problema doon sa pagpapatakbo ng pondo o ng budget ng Department of Health and other issues related doon sa mga findings ng COA.
State Insurer PhilHealth halts the implementation of a controversial circular that would have suspended the payment of COVID-19 claims of hospitals and other health facilities. This comes after PhilHealth President and CEO Dante Guerin admitted the state insurer still owed hospitals some 21 billion pesos in COVID claims. The circular had drawn sharp criticisms from hospital groups, with some even threatening to disengage from PhilHealth. The lower house last week held a mediation between the two sides and asked PhilHealth to halt its implementation. But PhilHealth says other measures which are meant to curb fraudulent claims will continue.
Vice President Lenny Robredo laughs off President Rodrigo Duterte's claim he would audit the whole government if he becomes the next VP. Robredo says Duterte should instead release his statement of assets, liabilities, and net worth, or SALEN, if he wants to prove his administration's commitment against corruption. Duterte has not released a SALEN since 2018.
Wala yun sa mandato namin. Yung mandato ng VP, succession lang. Creative na lang kami. Kaya meron kami mga anti-poverty program. Meron kami mga programa ngayong COVID. Pero yung pag-audit ka, Eli, nakalagay yan sa isang constitutional body para may independence. Hindi napapakialaman ng ibang branches of government.
A report by the International Criminal Court shows there is overwhelming support for an all-out investigation into the Duterte administration's bloody war on drugs from the victims themselves. More than 1,500 individual victims and over 1,000 families affected by the crackdown submitted their views to the ICC. 94% of them want a probe into the possible crimes against humanity committed in the anti-narcotics campaign. Apart from extrajudicial killings, the victims claim to have experienced other abuses such as torture, enforced disappearance, and sexual violence. These submissions will aid the pretrial chamber, acting upon the Office of the Prosecutor's request to open an investigation into the drug war. Former ICC Prosecutor Fatou Bensouda had asked for a probe into President Duterte's campaign from 2016 to 2019, as well as killings in Davao City from 2011 to 2016.
For more on this, we are joined this morning by Bayan Secretary General Renato Reyes Jr. Good morning, Nato. Thanks for joining us.
Hi, good morning, Mike, and to our viewers.
Right, Nato, let me get your reaction first on this latest development coming from the International Criminal Court. An overwhelming number, 94% of the representation submitted to the ICC through its Victims Participation and Reparations section wants the ICC to conduct a full-blown probe on the drug war killings in the Philippines. This is not evidence yet, but how significant is this for you, who have long objected to Oplan Tokang against drug suspects?
Well, this is significant because the victims themselves want the case to move forward, 94%. Only a few had doubts or uncertainties regarding the case moving forward. Also, this gives a face to the different victims. You know, they have come forward with their stories. They have narrated their experiences, you know, ranging from extrajudicial killings to other human rights violations. So this has to be considered by the ICC as an important factor in moving the case forward in the level of a preliminary investigation. So we hope that this case reaches its logical conclusion, that of holding the Duterte government, Rodrigo Duterte himself, accountable for all the rights violations that they have committed.
Now, among the crimes alleged, murder ranks high, but are you surprised that along with murder, other crimes are also indicated? In fact, murder and other crimes represent half of the submissions based on the entries submitted by the victims.
Yes, I noticed that. It's not just the extrajudicial killings. Probably there were arbitrary detention, there were enforced disappearances, even sexual violence. No? Although it did not seem to be a lot reported, but the ICC itself were saying that these cases are underreported in the Philippines. So there's a lot to do in terms of achieving accountability for these cases. And it's sad that even the Department of Justice right now has not really made much headway, because these cases exist and the government, the Philippine government, should have been investigating these cases in the first place.
Mm. Now, from Tokhang on drug suspects, let's now go to Tokhang against activists. There's this development in the Cordillera region. I understand there have been attempts before to implement Tokhang against activists, but this did not prosper. And so you have a new development where Tokhang will now be implemented against local government units, religious sector, NGOs, and they're calling this Dumanum Makitungtong, Ilocano for visit and discuss. How alarming is this for you?
Well, that resolution is patently illegal. First, the very title, they're going around to visit members of known communist front organizations. What are your parameters? Now, for saying that this person is a known member of a communist front organization, how would you determine what a communist front organization is? By who says so? The DILG, the NICA, no, the same people who filed 600 names with the DOJ in the terrorist prescription case. This is red tagging being institutionalized, and this is red tagging going house to house. It is more dangerous than the social media red tagging. Kasi dito, pupuntahan ka na eh, no? And you're being accused of what? Of providing support for the CPP, NPA, NDF. And they will plead to you to stop supporting. So what is their basis for that? No? The intelligence reports, unvetted the intelligence reports, delicado po yan, no? That is very, very dangerous, and that violates presumption of innocence, that violates freedom of association. No? So when the PNP chief says, oh, we will respect human rights, no, you already violated human rights when you made accusations against these people. Kaya delicado po talaga.
And what do you make of PNP Chief Guillermo Eleazar's 180-degree turn in his position on this? Initially, he said there were gray areas in the campaign, so he advised local authorities to resort to other measures. But the day after, he instructed the Cordillera Police Director to coordinate with the Regional Peace and Order Council to implement the new policy.
Well, it still remains a gray area. There are lots of gray areas. The resolution itself is very vague. How they will implement it is very vague. So can General Eleazar guarantee that human rights will not be violated when they implement this? And is he willing to resign the moment human rights violations take place? That is my challenge to him. Hindi po pwede na hayaan lang ito, no? Without any clear parameters, no? In violation of the law, in violation of the Constitution. What happens if the person they visited does not want to cooperate? Will he be killed after? Will they send in the death squads after? Because he has already been marked. He has been identified as a supporter. So does that mean that he will be killed if he does not cooperate? Ganun mangyayari dito, no? Napakalala nung kanilang pinaplano.
And are there any precedents to this? Have there been any incidents before, even before the implementation supposedly of this policy, where activists have been targeted, visited in their homes by authorities?
Marami, no? So many activists, even ordinary farmers, are being forced to surrender. Now, even if they are not armed members of the NPA, they are being forced to surrender. They are being paraded before the media. We saw some of them being photoshopped even by the military. For what? No, just to claim that the military is winning the war and that these people are being coerced and are now surrendering, that is also a human rights violation. Hindi po pwede yung ganoon. You are being accused of a crime. You don't know what crime. You have no other recourse. Now, what are the mechanisms to dispute the allegations of the police? There are none. So you are already tagged as a criminal, no, without any due process. It's guilt by association. Maling-mali po talaga yun.
And why Cordillera of all the regions? We're not hearing similar efforts in other regions. Is Cordillera now the hotbed of communism?
I don't know. I don't know why Cordillera. Honestly, no, that there have been reports of human rights violations as well in Cordillera. Our chairperson, Wendell Balingit, our local chapter chairperson, was slapped with trumped up charges. And fortunately, those charges have been dismissed. So mainit sila, no, sa mga activists, probably because the Cordillera activists are active against mining operations, against large-scale dams, no, against the environmental destruction. Probably, no, they want to neutralize that kind of people's resistance from the grassroots.
All right, let me shift now to the Senate investigations on the purchase of COVID supplies by the DBM Procurement Service. Are you satisfied so far with the explanations given by former Undersecretary Christopher Lau?
Well, first off, hindi totoo na walang overpricing, and I think there have been already evidence, no? There has been evidence presented that there are lower prices available. What is disturbing right now is that certain contracts, multi-billion peso contracts, were given to companies with supposed links to the president. So it calls for a deeper investigation. How were these companies awarded so much, no, in terms of contracts? How is it that these companies who have been undercapitalized, who have just been recently incorporated, are awarded billions in contracts? Ang swerte-swerte naman itong mga kumpanya ito. Does it have something to do with their links with the president? Because we've seen the videos recently circulating in social media, no, formally in Davao, meeting with the president. What does that all mean? Does that signal that they are a favored company for Malacanang and that they should be receiving these hefty contracts? Kailangan pong maimbestigahan.
Are you convinced that Lau was not recruited by anyone, was not asked by anybody in the president's circle to become the USEC for DBMPS? Because he's not divulging who actually asked him to become USEC. He's saying he applied for the position.
No, nothing of that sort can actually happen unbeknownst to Malacanang. You're talking of important positions in government dealing with billions of pesos of in contracts. How can somebody get approval and get an appointment without the knowledge of the higher ups? No? And everybody knows who Christopher Lau is and his relation to Senator Bongo. That has already been established. No? So paano siya nalagay dyan ng walang kinalaman yung mga bossing niya? It's kind of hard to believe. It stretches the imagination.
Senator Bongo now calling for the resignation of Secretary Duque.
Probably a misdirection, probably a distraction from the investigation. They want to put out the fire. They want the Senate to stand down. They want to appease the public, and the sacrificial lamb would be Secretary Duque. But Duque would not have been that powerful and not been committing these misdeeds with impunity without presidential approval. No, he has been defended so many times. So the problem is not just Duque. The problem is President Duterte. The problem is the whole Duterte administration.
Mm-hmm. And now you have this question surrounding government purchase, how the funds were spent, but you also now have health workers set to hold mass walkouts today because they still have not received their benefits from government. So from what you're hearing from your member organizations, how severe is the situation that it had to come to this?
Well, it has been so severe since last year. No, our health workers are overworked, underpaid. No, and they have not been receiving the necessary benefits, the special risk allowance, the meal and transportation allowance, and then they see billions of pesos being funneled to overpriced PPEs. No, they cannot really stomach this kind of corruption, while health workers are being neglected. So we stand with our health workers. Today is National Heroes Day, and it's important we stand with our health workers in their demands for benefits and in their demands to change the entire pandemic response of the regime, because apparently it is not working and the frontliners are already suffering. The hospitals are over capacity, you know, ICU beds are about to be almost filled up. No? So, kawawa talaga sila. No? And their protests are justified. Wag po natin masamain na nagpo-protesto yung mga health workers. They are right to protest because they have been neglected for the longest time by this regime.
And not to just to bring it home and to illustrate the situation, I understand that your wife is a doctor. So from your wife's case, how much has she received from the government since last year? And is it enough?
But maliit lang, no? I don't want to announce the amount, pero maliit lang talaga. And last week, they have been busy trying to accomplish forms because they needed to submit because there was a deadline and the whole hospital was trying to fill up forms. So ganun kagulo yung sistema. No? Then nagahabol sila ngayon because of this deadline imposed by the government. At the end of the day, no, ang masisingil talaga dito, the Duterte government abandoning the health workers, neglecting the health workers, and prioritizing corruption over everything else.
All right. Thank you so much for your thoughts and for joining us this morning, Renato Reyes, Secretary General of Bayan. And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, Hurricane Ida slams into Louisiana as an extremely dangerous Category 4 storm.
And a faction of PDP Laban ousts President Rodrigo Duterte as chairman of the Philippines' ruling party. These and more when the rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Philippine capital region has completed yet another two-week lockdown. What are we doing right? And what are we still doing wrong? Have you gotten your own confidence of how you are handling it? Wala silang ganon. Walang sila semblance sila ng pamamaraan ng pag-iimbestiga. Nobody gives you money for research. Nobody donates to you. Where does it start and where will it end? It's the president saying that no, you release it in 10 days.
Catch Tina Monzon Palma reports only here on ANC. Be right.
Don't
be
ask,
first.
Just throw away questions.
In that order. That's how we break the news. We don't just narrate events as they unfold. We gather insights from all sides to help you see through the spin. That is ANC's Rundown. Monday to Friday at 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. and Saturday at 8 a.m. here on ANC.
There still is a lot of fear, which is why investors continue to stay on the side. The expectation is for inflation to pick up a little bit.
Treat this market, take advantage of the strength.
Violence returns to the streets of Hong Kong. The UN chief also urging world leaders to take the lead in the fight against climate change.
Carmina Constantine bringing you the latest news Monday to Friday at 12 noon on Dateline Philippines.
Thank you.
Rev is leveling up with a fresh new coat of paint. We're going beyond cars and deep into car culture, tech, collectibles, and everything in between. We've got a new crew member too.
Hi guys, I'm Nikki De Guzman. So when I'm not behind the news desk, I'm a toy collector, I'm a gamer, and I'm pretty much your all-around geek. So I'm joining the Rev crew to bring you the latest in car.
Government allocates a budget of 20 billion pesos to hire more health workers as frontliners threaten to hold mass resignations. Manila Bulletin said line, the Philippines launches cube satellites in space. Topping GMA News' website, the growing rift in the ruling party PDP Laban as the Pacquiao faction votes to replace President Duterte as its chairman. And CNN Philippines' banner story, the latest COVID-19 figures in the country.
And fighting continues in the country's ruling party, PDP Laban. The faction of Senator Manny Pacquiao has booted out President Rodrigo Duterte as the party chairman, replacing Duterte, Senator Coco Pimentel, following an election held on Sunday by members who still see Pacquiao as the party president. Another PDP faction earlier voted for Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi to be the new party president. That same group called the election of Pimentel as chairman a comedy. They maintain President Duterte is still the official chairman. The rift among members of PDP Laban surfaced in March due to differences in who they wanted to field as a party standard bearer for the 2022 national elections.
A Philippine party list calls on the poll body to increase the benefits for teachers serving in next year's elections. Under the Election Service Reform Act, those who are rendering poll services can receive an honoraria of around 2,000 to 6,000 pesos depending on their duties. But the Alliance of Concerned Teachers says the benefits should be raised, especially with the threat of COVID-19. A resolution has been filed in lower house appealing for the increase.
Yung allowance na hinihingi natin, yung dagdag na allowance, ay maliit na bagay na pagpapakita ng gobyerno na binavalue, pinapahalagan ng wasto yung sakripisyo at yung pagharap ng ating mga teachers na magsisilbing bahagi ng poll election workers ay napaka-importante, no? Kaysa dun sa risk na kakaharapin. Kailangan tugunan ito ng COMELEC. At saka hindi tayo naniniwala doon sa kanilang sinasabi na kulang yung pondo, no? Kasi kailangan nila ipaglaban ito.
But the Commission on Elections admits the request may not be granted since the budget for the 2022 polls was cut.
Ang medyo nanganganib ngayon, yung wish list nila, no? Yung mga hinihingi nilang extra, no? And hinihingi nilang aumento, dagdag doon sa honoraria. Yun ang kailangan natin pagdesisyonan kung gaano kalaki yung dagdag na ibibigay natin.
In other news, the United Arab Emirates resumes issuing tourist visas to travelers inoculated with a World Health Organization-approved vaccine. The rule applies to citizens of all countries, including those arriving from previously banned nations. It's part of the country's strategy to support its economic recovery from the pandemic. Arriving passengers on tourist visa must undergo rapid COVID-19 testing at the airport. The WHO has so far approved shots from AstraZeneca, Johnson & Johnson, Moderna, Pfizer, Sinopharm, and Sinovac. The UAE's new rule goes into effect today, August 30th.
Israel ignores an appeal from the World Health Organization and begins offering a third dose to those already fully vaccinated against COVID-19. More in this report.
Israel on Sunday began offering a COVID-19 booster to children as young as 12, and its prime minister said a campaign that began a month ago among the older population has slowed a rise in severe illness caused by the Delta variant. Announcing the decision, top Israeli health officials said people are 10 times more protected after a third vaccine dose. Those eligible for the third shot can receive it, providing at least 5 months have passed since their second jab, a time frame shorter than the 8-month interval in effect in the United States. So far, 2 million people out of a population of 9.3 million have received three doses. Israel and other countries have pressed ahead with booster plans despite opposition from the World Health Organization, which said more of the world should be vaccinated with a first dose before people receive a third.
Video streaming giant YouTube has removed over a million videos for spreading COVID-19 misinformation. YouTube said since February 2020, it's been actively taking down videos on the platform showing false cures or people claiming COVID-19 as a hoax. For a group of doctors here in the Philippines, those who spread misinformation about COVID-19 and vaccines should be held liable.
Let's make a law against this fake news. And I think even yung mga doktor, no, this is my opinion, they should be held liable. I think their licenses should be reviewed. No, really. Get the evidence first. Because if there's no evidence of what's happening, then it's just your opinion.
12 crew members of the Liberian registered cargo vessel docked in Manila since last week have finally been brought to a quarantine facility. The MV Olympic arrived in Manila on August 23rd. It was turned away by China after 15 of its Filipino crew members tested positive for COVID-19. One of them died while en route back to the country. The body has already been offloaded from the ship and cremated. Seven crew members still remain on board as they wait for their replacements.
Ang initial plan, 13 kami nabababa muna, tapos may ilan yung iba, naghihintay ng kapalit. Itong agency namin, sige lang sila paasa. Yung dinadahilan nila, yung nakukuha raw nila na hotel na pang parang sinigisan sa amin. Umahayaw daw.
Meanwhile, the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration has prepared an assistance package for the MV Olympic crew, including scholarships for their children.
In business, after three straight weeks of rollback, local pump prices are set to go up this week. Gasoline prices may increase by up to 25 centavos per liter. Meanwhile, diesel and kerosene prices may go up by up to 70 centavos per liter. Industry players say the hike was due to improving oil demand in China and the U.S.
Now here are some economic data releases we are monitoring this Monday. Thailand will come out with its July industrial production numbers. Industrial output in Thailand grew by 17.58% in June, the fourth straight month of increase amid a low base effect in 2020 due to the pandemic. Spain and Portugal will both post their July retail sales figures. And Germany will announce its August inflation print. The consumer price index in Germany stood at 3.8% in July, the highest level since December 1993, reflecting the reopening of Europe's largest economy.
A U.S. drone strike hits a suspected suicide bomber who was aiming to attack Kabul's airport. An official says secondary explosions following the strike indicate the vehicle had been carrying a substantial amount of explosive material. U.S. Central Command is still investigating if the bombing caused any civilian casualties. The strike is the second carried out by U.S. forces since an Islamic State suicide bomber struck the airport on Thursday, killing 13 U.S. troops and scores of Afghan civilians trying to flee the country. The violence comes as the U.S. nears the August 31 deadline to pull all American forces from Afghanistan.
U.S. President Joe Biden flies to Dover Air Base in Delaware to honor soldiers killed in last week's suicide bombing in Afghanistan. After arriving at the base, Biden and his wife Jill met with the families of service members killed in the attack. Amid sounds of anguish, they watched as 11 flag-draped coffins were loaded into vans. The remains of two more service members will be transferred in an event not covered by media at the request of their families. Thursday's attack, which was claimed by Islamic State, was the most lethal incident for U.S. service members in Afghanistan in a decade. This has added fuel for Biden's critics, who accused the administration of bungling the U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan. And we are taking another breather. Still to come, pole vaulter EJ Obiena sets a new Philippine record in Paris.
And we talk with the Philippine Space Agency about the newest Pinoy satellites orbiting the Earth. These and more when the rundown returns.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Here on ANC.
Welcome back. Here's another rundown of the day's biggest stories. The Philippines registers its highest COVID-19 positivity rate ever, with more than 1 in 4 people tested turning out positive for the disease.
Health workers from various hospitals set to stage walkouts today due to the delayed payout of COVID-19 benefits.
Over 1,500 victims of the Duterte administration's war on drugs called for an all-out probe by the International Criminal Court.
And U.S. President Joe Biden warns of immense devastation as Ida makes landfall in Louisiana as a Category 4 hurricane. After honoring U.S. service members killed in Afghanistan, U.S. President Joe Biden went straight to a meeting with emergency officials as Hurricane Ida made landfall in Louisiana.
We've already pre-positioned resources that we know are going to be needed, and equipment and response teams in the region. This includes 2.5 million meals, 3 million liters of water. We've got generators in place, and we're in close touch with the power providers to get and restore power as soon as possible, because a lot of it's going to go out, and we should be prepared that it can take a long time, no matter how much we've pre-positioned, which we have, that it's going to take a long time for a lot of it to get back up. It could take a matter of weeks for some places.
The hurricane slammed into the state as an extremely dangerous Category 4 storm. Ida is now packing winds of up to 210 kilometers per hour, down from 240 kilometers per hour when it made landfall. Predicted storm surges are already happening, exceeding 6 feet in some parts of the coast. The National Hurricane Service has also warned of potentially catastrophic wind damage and up to 2 feet of rainfall in some areas. Ida intensified faster than officials predicted,
prompting business closures and evacuations along the Gulf Coast. Louisiana Governor John Bel Edwards says it could be the worst storm to hit the state since the 1850s.
If you're sheltering in place, please make sure that you're in the most secure place possible in your home, some interior space, and then please make it your business to stay there until the danger passes. There is no doubt that the coming days and weeks are going to be extremely difficult for our state. And many, many people are going to be tested in ways that we can only imagine today. But I can also tell you that as a state, we've never been more prepared. Again, all the models that we've seen from the Army Corps of Engineers and from our own CPRA show that the Hurricane Storm Damage Risk Reduction System will hold and perform as intended. Will it be tested? Yes. But it was built for this moment.
Ida will be the toughest test yet of the billions of dollars spent on Navy upgrades following Hurricane Katrina 16 years ago, which killed more than 1,800 people.
Let's now get an update on the weather here at home from Pag-asa weather forecaster Ariel Rojas. Ariel, good morning. What more can you tell us?
Hi, good morning, Mike. The Intertropical Convergence Zone, or ITZZ, is currently affecting the entire country, and scattered rain showers and thunderstorms will be experienced over Metro Manila, Cagayan Valley, Central Luzon, Calabarzon, Mimaropa, Bicol Region, and Pangasinan, while the rest of Luzon and Visayas and Mindanao will experience warm and humid conditions, some cloudiness, and isolated thunderstorms, especially in the afternoon and in the evening. Flash floods and landslides are possible during severe thunderstorms. Today's maximum temperature in Metro Manila and in Cebu will be 32 degrees Celsius, and in Davao City, 33 degrees Celsius. Fisher folks and those with small sea craft can safely venture out as we are not expecting big waves over our seaboards, and no tropical cyclone formation is expected within and around the Philippine area of responsibility in the next 2 to 3 days. That's the latest on our weather from Pag-asa Weather Forecasting Center. This is Ariel Rojas. Good morning and stay safe, everyone.
Thank you, Ariel Rojas from Pag-asa, for that update.
And two Philippine-made Cube satellites were launched into space on Sunday as part of NASA's SpaceX commercial resupply mission to the International Space Station. For more on the development of Maya 3 and Maya 4, we are joined by Dr. Joel Marciano Jr., the Director General of the Philippine Space Agency. Good morning, Dr. Joel. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Nikki. Thank you for having me.
Okay, so first off, Dr. Joel, how did the launch go yesterday, and any updates on the whereabouts as well as the condition of the satellite since being officially launched into space?
Thank you for that question. The launch went well. It was a picture-perfect launch, I guess, as launches go. And the Cargo Dragon capsule that was deployed is still in orbit, actually, and it's on its way to rendezvous with the International Space Station. So that's expected to happen around 11 p.m. Tonight, Philippine Standard Time. So once the satellites, once the Cargo Dragon capsule docks with the ISS, the satellites will be brought inside the space station, and they will then be scheduled based on the astronauts' workload for deployment into orbit. So we don't have the details yet on when that will happen, but we hope that will be soon. And our colleagues in the program, Stamina for Space program, will certainly share word about it.
All right. And Dr. Joel, according to the DOST, this is the first time that two Philippine-made Cube satellites would be lofted together. What exactly are Cube satellites, ba? We know they gather ground data, among others, but what are the major differences, or should we say, how much of an improvement are Maya 3 and 4 from Maya 1 and 2?
Okay, maybe we can start first with how they are similar. All of these Maya CubeSats, they're 1 kilogram nano satellites, weighing about 1 kilogram.
So they're very small.
Yes, they're very small. And they're all built by Filipino students. So the first two were built by graduate students we sent to Japan to do their graduate degrees. So with Maya 3 and Maya 4, we brought that know-how home, and now we're implementing it in our own universities through the Stamina for Space program, which is funded by the DOST. So with Maya 3 and 4, just like Maya 1 and 2, they were conceptualized to test and demonstrate certain technologies such as radios, cameras, integrated circuits, and sensors. And that's why we call them technology demonstration nanosatellites. So once the performance of these devices satisfy our performance criteria, we can then use them in our next satellites for the more mainstream functions. So this is an important step to gain so-called space heritage, which when we achieve, we can open further industrial and commercial opportunities for these components and systems. Mm-hmm. So how are they different? Maya 1 and Maya 2 were built by graduate students in Japan, by Filipino graduate students in Japan. So Maya 3 and 4, they are built in a local university, specifically by master's students in the nanosatellite development track in UP Diliman, Electrical and Electronics Engineering Institute. And for the mission innovations, Maya 3 and 4 are designed to run experiments such as the use of a new GPS device, measuring the Earth's magnetic field from space for studying space weather. And there's also a new camera. We will use the store and forward radio to relay environmental measurements from sensors deployed in remote areas. But quickly, I think the big difference in Maya 3 and 4, apart from being implemented in the local university, is the attempt to integrate more local inputs. So when we sent scholars to Japan in 2016 to build the first one, we committed to the idea of building and innovating the next Maya CubeSats in our local laboratories. So these local laboratories contributed to the assembly of several Maya 3 and 4 electronic circuit boards, the mission board, rear access, VHF, solar panel boards, and the antenna boards. Yung tuning and testing of the antennas and communication system were performed in the testing chamber in UP. Radiation testing of some components were also done through the Philippine Nuclear Research Institute. And last, but definitely not the least, a local company was also engaged for providing some mechanical work on the CubeSats.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And Dr. Joe, the launch is part of NASA's SpaceX commercial resupply mission, right? To the ISS, to the International Space Station. What is a resupply mission exactly? Why does it need to be done? And how often do you carry out such missions?
Well, resupply mission brings supplies for the crew in the ISS. So they're carried out by spacecraft vehicles that rendezvous and subsequently dock or berth with the ISS. That cargo includes food, water, air, oxygen, experiment payloads, and tools or replacement parts for maintaining or repairing or upgrading the ISS. So the ISS is a platform for long-term research. So they conduct experiments there in a microgravity environment, for studying things like human health, biological studies such as growing plants, testing commercial products like 3D printers and coffee machines. So these experiments need to be brought to the station. How often? Maybe about a handful of times a year, between 8 to 12 times or so. Perhaps so long as there are astronauts in the ISS, so long as there are experiments to be made, and perhaps so long as the ISS continues to be in service, there will be resupply missions. So these resupply missions are done currently by Japan through JAXA, the Russians through the Soyuz and Progress capsules, and the US, which has been using a commercial resupply service provided by SpaceX. And I think there's one more company using a Cygnus capsule, Northrop Grumman, I believe.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned earlier how it was the students who were the team behind the project, but could you walk us through the timeline of the project as well, from its design, from its completion, launch, and ultimately to its operation thereafter?
Okay. Well, we started, it began in 2016, actually, when we sent the first batch of students to Japan, to Kyushu Institute of Technology, to study this technology. They took their master's and their doctoral degrees then. And the program is really about countries who are getting into this area, and then they can take the technology to their countries and to their schools and start implementing it. So we committed to that idea. Maya 1 was built that way. Maya 2 as well, a second batch of students were sent to Japan. That was around 2017 when we sent a second batch of students there. And so Maya 1 and Maya 2, we learned from that. And now we decided, okay, let's build Maya 3 and 4 using our local laboratories. So a couple of these students who worked on these satellites came back to the Philippines. They're now part of the program. And they are working with us as well in various capacities. No? So we thought we'd recruit a new batch of students to start to go into the local universities under a government scholarship. in UP now, funded by DOST, to build Maya 3 and 4. So then they started working on that, and then the pandemic came, and they persevered. So that in early this year, they were able to hand over the CubeSats. I think that was in February of this year, they were able to hand over the CubeSats to JAXA. And from then on, JAXA took them and will be bringing them to the space station through the commercial resupply service.
Mm-hmm. And yesterday it was launched. No. So, Dr. Joel, you're also eyeing future partnerships in space programs, right, with the UAE Space Agency. Could you give us more details on the recently held bilateral meeting with the UAE SA? What areas of cooperation are you looking to explore? And are you also considering partnering with other countries?
Yes, the UAE and their space agency have accomplished a lot in a relatively short period of time. They were able to launch a space probe currently orbiting Mars. It's gathering data about the planet's atmosphere. So our cooperation, one cooperation is to work together on the data that they collect in Mars, which our Filipino scientists and researchers can use and contribute to analyzing. We will explore also a cooperation on space education, space policy, access and processing of satellite images and data, and promoting opportunities for building and strengthening space industries. So it's possible to have joint activities, not just between our universities, but also among research institutions and companies in our two countries. So a memorandum of understanding on space cooperation between PhilSA and the UAE SA is under preparation. We also have been discussing, or we also discussed with recently with the Argentinian Space Agency. This is a CONAE. And recently also had a meeting with the French space agency CNES for possible participation in the Space Climate Observatory, and also coordinating with the European Space Agency on a national support program where we, the Philippines, will host, archive, and expand utilization of data coming from their Copernicus satellite constellation.
Mm-hmm. And lastly, Dr. Joel, you know, given our improvements in the field of space science and technology, to our experiences in building the Duwata satellite, the recent Mula satellite, and now we have two additional Maya satellites, what's your outlook on the future for Filipino space projects?
Oh, we are optimistic, definitely. You know, building these CubeSats and these larger satellites provide us an opportunity to acquire space technology know-how through hands-on satellite development. In other words, you know, we're learning by doing. So we're now able to teach these in our classrooms and labs. So we're starting a multiplier effect that will create a critical mass of specially trained engineers, scientists, project managers, and even administrators. So this contributes to a knowledge workforce that hopefully can build startups or be absorbed by companies so they can venture into the new space economy. They can also teach in schools and universities, thus propagating further the know-how. So our engineers, you mentioned from Mula satellite, have also just come back from the UK from the first phase of their activities, and we hope to start the next phase soon. So promoting and intensifying our country's space capabilities will help the development of our economy through more informed policies, through satellite data, high-value industries, and a knowledge workforce. So things continue to move forward, and everyone is motivated.
Right, that's very good to hear. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Joel. You stay safe, Paul.
Thank you, Nikki.
Meanwhile, in sports, Filipino pole vaulter EJ Opiena breaks his own record after clearing 5.91 meters in the Paris leg of the Wanda Diamond League. The Philippine Athletics Track and Field Association commended Obiena's feat as he smashed the old record of 5.87 meters, which he set last June during the World Athletics Continental Tour in Poland. The Filipino finished second in the Paris leg behind Olympic champion Armand Duplantis of Sweden. He earned 16 qualifying points in the event, putting him in the fourth place among pole vaulters who are looking to make the Diamond League finals in Zurich, which will be held in September.
Now here's an update on our Filipino athletes in the ongoing Tokyo Paralympics. Wheelchair racer Gerald Mangliwan recorded a new personal best in the final of the men's 1,500-meter event. He finished at 3 minutes and 58 seconds, which is 10 seconds better than his previous record. However, Mangliwan was unable to reach the podium, with Japan's Sato Tomoki nabbing the gold. He will compete again this week for the 100-meter race.
A few movies from the past get reboots, including the 1992 supernatural horror film Candyman, and the 1999 teen romance movie She's All That. Let's find out what Manny the Movie Guy thinks about them in this report.
If you say his name five times.
Candyman, the boogeyman who scared us in the 90s, is back in theaters with a new sequel that improves upon the spirit of the original. Candyman. The hero here is director Nia DaCosta, who's able to give a fresh new take on the urban legend.
Story all about Candyman.
Take note, this is a thinking man's horror movie, so it's more cerebral than scary, but it's a welcomed improvement on the Candyman universe. And for that, Candyman gets 3 out of 4 Candyman kisses. And another 90s movie that's getting an update, She's All That. Now we have He's All That. Streaming on Netflix, this gender swap reimagining has Addison Rae as the popular kid, and Tanner Buchanan is her project, the next prom king.
Really can't enjoy this without.
Giving support are the stars of the original, Rachel Lee Cook and Matthew Lillard.
It's just the movie did need an update.
For the fans of the original, have no fear.
Sweet, funny, and charming, and I think it does justice to the original.
I think that we would give the same review to you as a human. You are all of those things.
Sweet, kind, and
funny. And charming. So
cute. And for that, He's All That gets 3 out of 4 Kiss Me Kisses. And only in theaters, the devastatingly funny Together.
I hate your face.
James McAvoy and Sharon Horgan star as an unmarried couple during the lockdown. So what happens when you really don't know the person you're with?
I mean, not really.
From director Stephen Daldry, who gave us Billy Elliot and The Hours, the film will make you laugh, cry, and think, and will give you hope. Excellent script with top-notch acting.
I'm saying this under the banner of rigorous honesty.
And for that, Together gets 3.5 out of 4 must-see kisses. And finally, we have Swan Song.
And I'm back.
Character actor Udo Kier stars as Pat, a flamboyant hairdresser plucked out of retirement to style a dead woman's hair.
If I make you cry, it's good to cry sometimes.
Like Together, you will laugh and cry in Swan Song. This is Udo Kier's movie and he owns it from start to finish. And for that, Swan Song gets 3.5 out of 4 See This Now kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
Coming up on ANC, at 9 a.m., Market Edge talks to Don Pansapola of NextPay. Also on the show, SOC Resources Chairman Edgardo Reyes. And for today's Market Outlook, Manny Lisbona, PNB Securities.
And at 12 noon, Dateline Philippines speaks with Malay Town Councilor Ninette Aguirre Graff on President Rodrigo Duterte's plan to allow gambling operations in Boracay.
Right, let's now talk to Ms. Karen Davila for today's guests on Head Start. Happy morning, Ms. Karen. How are you doing now?
Good morning.
Hello, I'm feeling better. And I want to thank you, Mike, first of all, for doing Head Start last Friday. Mm-hmm. So good morning to you and Nikki. And today I'll be speaking actually to the Alliance of Health Workers and also the St. Luke's Medical Center Employees Association in Quezon City. We'll be talking about the mass walkouts and the protests that health workers have planned for today. Find out just how this affects hospital operations in the midst of the COVID pandemic. And later we'll also be speaking to Dr. Rodjean Solante just to update on cases and also the Lambda variant and the Delta variant in the Philippines.
It's interesting that these walkouts are happening on National Heroes Day. We're honoring healthcare workers as heroes.
But you really can't blame them, you know? Yeah.
Exactly. Right. So thank you for joining us this morning, Ms. Karen Davlis. Good to see you again. And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navallo. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
Thank you.
mobility will be key to recovery.